Acute kidney injury, or AKI, is when the kidney's not functioning at 100%. And that decrease in function usually develops relatively quickly, typically over the course of a few days. Actually, AKI used to be known as acute renal failure, or ARF. But AKI is a broader term that also includes subtle decreases in kidney function. AKI can essentially be split into three types. Pre-renal AKI, meaning the cause of the kidney injury is coming before the kidneys. Post-renal AKI, meaning after the kidneys. Or intra-renal AKI, meaning within the kidneys. Now, the kidney's job is to regulate what's in the blood. So they might remove waste, or make sure electrolyte levels are steady, or regulate the overall amount of water, and even make hormones. The kidneys do a lot of stuff. Blood gets to the kidneys through the renal artery, into tiny clumps of arterioles called glomeruli, where it's initially filtered, with the filtrate, the stuff that gets filtered out, moving into the renal tubule. Sometimes fluid or electrolytes can move back from the filtrate into the blood, called reabsorption. And sometimes more fluid or electrolytes can move from the blood to the filtrate, called secretion. Along with fluid and electrolytes, though, waste-containing compounds can also be filtered, like urea and creatinine. Although some urea is actually reabsorbed back into the blood, whereas only a little bit of creatinine is reabsorbed. In fact, in the blood, the normal ratio of blood urea nitrogen, or BUN, to creatinine is between 5 and 20 to 1, meaning the blood carries 5 to 20 molecules of urea for every 1 molecule of creatinine. And this is a pretty good diagnostic for looking at kidney function. Ultimately, that filtrate is turned into urine and is excreted from the kidneys through the ureter into the bladder and peed away. Meanwhile, the filtered blood drains into the renal vein. Alright, so with post-renal AKI, there's some obstruction to the outflow from the kidneys. Reduced flow can be a result of something compressing the ureter, like intra-abdominal tumors, or compressing the urethra further down, like from benign prostatic hyperplasia, a non-cancerous growth of the prostate gland, both of which sort of pinch the ureter and urethra shut. Also, though, it could be from some blockage inside, like kidney stones getting stuck in the ureter or urethra, which can actually plug it up. Now, if only one ureter is obstructed, it's called unilateral obstruction. And if the other kidney's working fine, then renal function's actually usually preserved. If either both ureters are obstructed, which is called bilateral obstruction, or the urethra gets obstructed, then we've got a recipe for post-renal AKI. Whatever the obstruction is, it ultimately causes this buildup of urine and pressure that backs up into the kidney, all the way to the millions of tiny renal tubules. Normally, filtration moves fluid from the relatively high-pressure arteriole to the low-pressure renal tubule. But this backup causes an increase in renal tubule pressure, which reduces the pressure gradient and lowers the amount of fluid that filters across, which lowers the glomerular filtration rate, or GFR, which is how much blood the kidneys filter in milliliters through their glomeruli per minute. And this means that less waste products like urea and creatinine are filtered out of the blood, meaning more stays in the blood, which leaves people with azotemia, or high levels of nitrogen-containing waste compounds in the blood, as well as oliguria, low levels of urine. Now, if we follow the stuff that does make it into the tubule, which also includes things like sodium and water, it turns out that the high-pressure tubular system essentially forces more reabsorption of sodium, water, and urea, but not much creatinine, because remember, little to no creatinine gets reabsorbed. Now, this increased urea reabsorption relative to creatinine increases the BUN to creatinine ratio in the blood, typically making it greater than about 15 to 1. Also, while the tubules aren't functioning normally and reabsorbing appropriately, the urine sodium is typically less than 20 milliequivalents per liter, since most of that sodium is being reabsorbed, which means that the fraction of sodium excreted to sodium filtered, or FENA, is usually less than 1%. And finally, since most of that water and fluid is being reabsorbed as well, the urine's typically pretty concentrated, usually greater than 500 milliosmoles per kilogram. Alright, so I said normally before because over time, that increased pressure damages the epithelial cells that are responsible for reabsorption in the tubules. When that happens, less and less urea gets reabsorbed back into the blood, and instead it stays in the tubule and then gets dumped out into the urine. and this causes the BUN to creatinine ratio in the blood to fall below 15 to 1. Also, in the same way, less sodium is reabsorbed, so more gets excreted and urine sodium goes above 40 milliequivalents per liter, and FENA goes above 1% in mild cases, but in severe cases it can go above 2%. Finally, just as with the others, less water and fluid being reabsorbed causes the urine to be less concentrated, and urine osmolality falls below 350 milliosmoles per kilogram. Alright, so as a quick recap, post-renal acute kidney injury is where the kidneys aren't functioning at 100%, and this is due to some obstruction in the ureters that blocks the flow of urine. Now that you know all about post-renal AKI, check out these other two videos on pre-renal AKI and intra-renal AKI. Thanks for watching. You can help support us by donating on Patreon, or subscribing to our channel, or telling your friends about us on social media.